just because he lives. Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon, it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy great help I've come, and I safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger, interposed his precious blood. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above.
blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, hero of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, raising my Savior
On behalf of the family and of Sojourn Church, I just want to say welcome and thank you for being here. My name is Jason. I'm one of the pastors of Sojourn Church. And it's meaningful and it's good that during times like these, we get together. Throughout the scriptures, we see over and over that one of the ways God comforts us when we're down, when we're sad, when we're grieving, is by sending a friend, by telling us to live in community and get together and grieve with those who grieve and rejoice with those who rejoice. And so I just want to say thank you, whether you drove across the street or whether you drove from out of town, thank you for making it a priority to be here today. I would love to open with prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you as children. Thank you that we can approach you with confidence because of who Jesus is and what he's done. God, I want to start by just saying thank you for the life of Rich Meddings. Thank you for everything good, everything beautiful about his life. Thank you for every way that he blessed others, every way that he loved others, and thank you, God, that you captured his heart and mind and transformed his life. God, we start by saying thank you. And God, I also ask that not only in the next 45 minutes to an hour, but even after that, but especially during this service, God, would you use music? Would you use your Bible? Would you use the reflections of those who loved him as we encourage each other and share stories? God, would you comfort us who are hurting? Now, would you draw near and may your presence be our peace? We praise you. Amen.
I'm going to be doing the scripture reading. It's going to be Psalms 22 and Psalms 23. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but I find no rest. Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. In you our fathers trusted. They trusted, and you delivered them. To you they cried and were rescued. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not a man, scorned by mankind and despised by people. All who see me mock me. They make mouths at me. They wag their heads. He trusts in the Lord. Let him deliver him. Let him rescue him, for he delights in him. Yet you are he who took me from the womb. You made me trust you at my mother's breast. On you was I cast from my birth, and from my mother's womb you have been my God. Be not far from me, for trouble is near, and there is none to help. Many bulls encompass me. Strong bulls of Bashan surround me. They open wide their mouths at me like a raven and roaring lion. I am proud like water. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted within my breast. My strength is dried up like the potsherd, and my tongue sticks to my jaws, and you lay me in the dust of death. For dogs encompass me. A company of evildoers encircles me. They have pierced my hands and feet. I can count all my bones. They stare and gloat over me. They divide my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. But you, O Lord, do not be far off. You, my help, come quickly to my aid. Deliver my soul from the sword and my precious life from the power of the dog. Save me from the mouth of the lion. You have rescued me from the horns of wild oxen. I will tell you of your name to my brothers, and to the midst of the congregation I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you offspring of Jacob, Glorify him and stand in awe of him, all you offspring of Israel. For he has not despised or abhorred the affliction of the afflicted, and he has not hidden his face from him, but has heard when he cried to him. From you comes my praise in the great congregation. My vows I will perform before those who fear it. The afflicted shall eat and be satisfied, and those who seek him shall praise the Lord. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations shall worship before you. For the kingship belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. All the prosperous of the earth eat and worship, and him shall bow all who go down to dust, even the one who could not keep himself alive. Posterity shall serve him and shall be told of the Lord to the coming generation. They shall come and proclaim his righteousness to a people yet unborn, yet he has done it. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Love you, Dad.
So Dad, he could be stubborn, and even at times he could be a little hard-headed. His brother Walt usually referred to him as knucklehead, and I really did enjoy the banter between the two of you. But these things weren't necessarily a bad thing. After Dad had accepted Christ into his life, you couldn't convince him God wasn't real. That was an argument you would never win. There was just something about Dad that you had to love. You couldn't help but love. The way he was meticulous about certain things, like how you would get dressed Sunday mornings for church, and yet still have the same attitude. No shoes, no shirt, no problems. Maybe you loved him because he was never afraid to speak his mind, and he was often the voice of reason. Or perhaps you admired his strength and his courage to overcome the many trials and adversity he faced. I think most of us would agree. The thing that we loved about him the most was his ability to make us laugh. Dad brought laughter with him everywhere he went. Whether it was him acting like a goofball or reminiscing about his wild youthful days, he seemed to just know how to get a good laugh out of you. Now, I've only heard the tall tales of his childhood days, but most of you lived them. And I actually came across some personal testimonies in his 7th grade yearbook. I promise I won't read them all, but Tim White simply said, "He's a nut." Vicky Wells said, "To Richard, a real sweet boy, though sometimes he is a real nut. The thing that I loved about Dad the most was his heart of generosity. He often would open up his home to anyone and everyone. And he took great joy in cooking up delicious meals for all to enjoy. I know my personal favorite was his baked mac and cheese. I usually would ask him to bake that for me instead of a cake on my birthdays. And if you ever needed something or simply just took interest in something that he had, Dad would want to give it to you. He delighted in being able to provide. And when Dad met Mom for the first time on a blind date, many, many moons ago, he used every bit of his charismatic ways to pursue her hand in marriage. She was his soulmate. It was Dad's perfect match. And as much as I wish Dad was here right now to hear one more of his stories, to laugh one more time, I know that Dad is not suffering anymore. I know that God did not forsake him, but instead delivered him into his glorious kingdom to be reunited with his beautiful bride of 48 years, making this anniversary the best one yet. We'll always have the love and the laughter that he gave us and the memories that we share.
Assurance, control that Christ
has regarded my helpless estate. It has shed His own blood for my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. Sit on the bliss of this glorious throne. My seat not in part, but the whole is nailed to the cross. And I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul. It is well,
it is well
with my soul,
with my soul.
It is well, it is well with my soul. And Lord, haste the day when the fit shall be sight. The clouds be rolled back as a scroll. The trump shall resound in the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. It is well,
it is well
with my soul.
With my soul.
It is well. With my soul, with my
Richard Carlton Meddings, Sr., 70, went home to be with Jesus and to reunite with his beloved wife, Deborah, on their wedding anniversary, November 22, 2023. Richard was born on March 27, 1953, in Cheverly, Maryland, to the late Walter and Anna Meddings. After graduating from the Art Institute of Philadelphia, he worked as an architect for many years until his retirement. He was a member of Sojourn Church in Perry, Georgia, where he and his wife have served faithfully. In his spare time, Richard loved being at the beach or just lounging in the sun. He enjoyed working word puzzles, playing card games with his family, cooking, and entertaining. In addition to his parents, Richard was preceded in death by the love of his life, Deborah Meddings, and his sister, Patricia Meddings. Left to cherish his memory are his five sons, Richard Carlton Meddings II of Forsyth, Georgia, Christopher Meddings of Little River, South Carolina, Gregory Meddings and Ashley of Warner Robins, Georgia, Douglas Meddings of Warner Robins, Georgia, and Alec Meddings of McKenzie, Tennessee. 5 grandchildren, brother Walter Meddings II of Warner Robins, Georgia, sister Donna Jean Lehman of Somerdale, New Jersey. I loved and love Rich Meddings. We had many conversations, most of them not of the serious nature. We had a few serious conversations, but I almost did not wear a suit today because it was funny that you mentioned Sunday morning dress, because he picked at me. You're a pastor, and look how you dress. I generally, during the summer, when it's hotter outside, I just wear a collared shirt with 3 buttons, short sleeve. And he's like, man, at least put on a long sleeve with buttons all the way down. Why do you wear the 3-button shirts? I mean, you're a pastor. Eventually, he just got to the point where he gave me a nickname. He called me 3 Buttons. Pastor 3 Buttons was what he called me. One time, my wife and we were in a community group, a small group together, and we'd all bring food. And my wife cooked meatballs on the same night that he decided to bring his meatballs. And they broke out into an argument, which was very one-sided, about who made the better meatballs. Now, I don't think Bonnie ever claimed to make better meatballs, but they argued nonstop that night about who made the better meatballs. And then, I don't remember if it was that night or another night, but he found out that sometimes when Bonnie serves meatballs in her spaghetti, she doesn't make her spaghetti sauce 100% from scratch. And he lost all respect for, I think, for our whole family. I think he might have used the phrase, and you call yourself Italian. He loved to cook and bless people through food, and I was fortunate enough to be on the receiving end of that. Sometimes, something that happened more than once was he would be talking about food, and he would name a type of food that I had never heard of. And so I would say, Rich, I've never heard of that. And he would look at me like I was just ridiculous. I had never heard of that. He's like, really? Come over Wednesday, I'll make it for you. I remember one time we were talking, and he goes, oh, and I love panzerotti. Rich, I don't know what panzerotti is. Come over Wednesday, I'll make it for you. And so some of my best memories with him would be in his kitchen at his house, him cooking. And he would always, as Doug talked about his generosity, he would always send me home with something else. We'd eat whatever we ate, but then he'd say, come look in the freezer, come look in the pantry. Do you want salsa? You want some spaghetti sauce? Because that wife of yours doesn't know how to make it from scratch. I mean, what do you want? You want some, you know, how can you be so generous and hospitable and have the spiritual gift of sarcasm at the same time? I don't know. We used to do a chili cook-off as a church every year. And I think the maddest I've ever seen him was 2 years in a row, he got second place. And I mean, the judges had no clue whose chili was whose, and there was so many pots of chili that at the end of it, all of them taste the same. So they're basically just, I don't know, give it to that person. They can be second, whatever. But fate had it where his got second twice in a row. And I mean, he would corner me at this event and go, how is this happening? You know, and so he called me 3 Buttons. I started calling him second place. I love Rich Meddings. I want to share some reflections from Romans chapter 8, a very, very famous, popular section of Scripture. It may be one of the chapters of the Bible that has brought me the most comfort and the most hope during times of struggle, difficulty, and grief. I just want to kind of read through a few paragraphs and share some reflections from it. At a service like this, a funeral or memorial service, I always have 2 goals. And that, number one, is just to mix grief and celebration together. because it's good to be sad, because it means there was love. And so I want to help us just grieve and be comforted, Lord willing. But I also want to encourage us to make the most of the time we have, because a service of this nature reminds us of our mortality and reminds us that we are not promised tomorrow. And so I just want to seek to comfort as the Lord will, and also encourage us to make the most of the time we have. So I'm going to start in Romans chapter 8, verse 31. It says this: "What then shall we say to these things?" So he's obviously talking about his prior argument. Then he says, "If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies." Perhaps our chief enemy, who we call Satan, or maybe it's human enemies who may seek to condemn us, or maybe it's our own mind and our own conscience that says, you know, you'll never be loved, you'll never be forgiven, you've done something too bad. Whoever it is who may try to condemn us, this gives us hope that those who have come to faith in Christ will never, ever, ever be found guilty and never be condemned. It says God did not spare his only son, and it is God who justifies. It is God who declares us righteous and in right relationship with him. In fact, this chapter begins in verse 1 by saying, "There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." Verse 34 repeats the question: who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. So again, this issue of condemnation or being found guilty comes. Satan may whisper in our ear. We may seek to condemn ourselves with our conscience, but we can rejoice today that that rich and anyone else who has faith in Jesus will never be condemned. It says here that Christ died and paid the full penalty of our sins. But not only that, he was raised, showing that his death was effective. Our debt was paid in full, and he's still alive, serving us by interceding for us at the right hand of God. But these next few verses are the ones that I really wanted to get to and why I chose this text, verse 35. It says, "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword?" It's so easy to believe that when we're in distress, when we're undergoing tribulations, when there's a lot of suffering and pain, it's so easy to believe that that's a sign that God's abandoned us or left us or does not love us. So let me repeat the question that the Apostle Paul writes here. What can separate us from the love of Christ? Does tribulation separate us? Does distress separate us? Does persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or the sword separate us from the love of Christ? I chose this text specifically because of what Rich has been going through for, goodness, it seems like the last 4 or 5 years. I mean, distress after distress, tribulation after tribulation. It seemed like every week or month I was getting reached out to that something's going on medically. He's in the ER, he's in the ICU. Lots of tribulation, lots of distress in his last weeks, months, and even years. What separates us from the love of Christ, though? Let's continue. Verse 36. "As it is written, for your sake, we are being killed all day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered." And what this verse is saying is it was written in a time and to a people who were being persecuted for their faith in Christ. And so they were saying, you're suffering for your faith. But then verse 37 answers the question. Verse 37 says, "No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us." In all these things, in all what things? Tribulation, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, danger, and sword. In all these things, we are more than conquerors. I mean, that is a bold language and a strong claim. but we can be more than conquerors in all these things because we serve a God who can turn all sorts of things like pain and even death into good for those who love him and are called according to his purpose. I'm not saying that everything that happens to us is good, but we serve a God who can use all those things for good. I want to read these last two verses very, very slowly because these are the verses that just have been a balm to my soul for many years, and perhaps God would use it to do the same for you. He says this, "For I am sure that neither death nor life," the experience that Rich Meddings had this last week, "death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things to present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation." He's listing all these things. And then he says, and just to make sure that you don't say, "But what about this?" He says, "I'm just going to say anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." That's our hope. Nowhere in the scriptures does it promise people in general or Christians specifically that you won't face death or that you won't face tribulation or distress. But what it does say is that if we're in Christ, it will never, ever, ever separate you from the love of God. It will never separate you from the presence of God. Words of comfort and words to help us to make the most of the time that we have. So be comforted. Rich is not condemned. He is forgiven. He belongs. He's accepted. He's adopted. He's more alive right now than he's ever been. 2 Corinthians 5 would lead us to believe that Rich is not walking by faith, but he's actually walking by sight. He's away from the body and at home with the Lord. His pain, his grief, his sin, his death, none of that separated him from the love of God that is found in Christ Jesus. So we can grieve, and we do grieve, and I'm going to grieve because I miss him. But let's not grieve as those who have no hope. We have great hope. Let this text also inspire us to make the most of the time that we have. First, I encourage you to find all of your life in Christ. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that those who believe in him, those who trust on him, shall not perish but have everlasting life. Why are we not condemned according to Romans 8, the text that we read through? The reason we don't have to fear condemnation is because Christ lived a perfect life in our place and he died a sacrificial death on the cross that we deserve to die, but he did it in our place. He took what we deserve so that we could receive what he deserved. Let's trust Jesus. We don't know how many tomorrows we have, so I just invite you today to cast yourself upon the mercy and grace of God found in Jesus. And secondly, let's live every day as if this text is true, because I believe that it is. Nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, we can live risk-taking, bold, loving our neighbor, loving God to the fullest lives, because we know that no matter what happens, nothing can separate us from the love of God anyway that is found in Christ Jesus our Lord. Let's believe that the pains and the aches and the distresses and the hurts don't mean that God has forsaken us or abandoned us, but that even he can use those things for good. Let's live bold lives of love because nothing can separate us from the love of God. May God use these words to bring comfort and to bring courage and to help us live to glorify him and love each other. Let me pray. Father, thank you for the good news. Thank you for the good news. God, again, I say thank you for Rich and Deb, the blessing that they were to so many, to our church, to their friends, to their family. God, would you comfort us today? And God, would you compel us to live bold lives of love for your sake? We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'll remember you long after this endless summer is gone. I'll be lonely, oh so lonely, living only to remember you. I'll remember you. Your voice is soft as the warm summer breeze. Your sweet laughter mornings after, ever after, I'll remember you. To your arms someday I'll return to stay. Till then I will remember too. Every bright star we made wishes upon. Love me always, promise always. Ooh, you'll remember too. I